When there is a film that is popular, well-reviewed, and makes you money... Actually, scratch that. When a movie makes money, you can bet your bottom dollar that there will inevitably be a sequel. Many times, these sequels are straight-up trash at worst, or at best, not as good as the first. But sometimes, there are times when a sequel lives up to the first, or even surpasses the first film. Today, we are going to be discussing one of the best movie sequels ever made, Robocop 2. At the beginning of the film, we learn through a news report that the Surgeon General has been JFK'd by a cult member of the Nuke cult. Nuke being a hot new drug being manufactured by Kane, the main gangster guy somewhat fulfilling Clarence Boddicker's role from the first film. We also learn that the hints dropped about the cops wanting to strike from the first film are still around.
We should strike. Fuck them. We're not plumbers. We're police officers. And police officers don't strike.
Except now, things are worse than they were in the first.
OCP cut our salaries 40% and canceled our pensions. God knows why, but they want this strike.
We then see some of the crime-ridden streets as a gun shop is robbed by some dudes.
Where's the bullets for this gun, man?
Third drawer, bottom.
A few moments later.
I really like this gun, man.
I just take it and get out.
Thanks.
What you say? That it's all for the best.
They are promptly stopped by none other than Robocop. Robocop then goes after one of the manufacturing locations of Nuke. We also get some introduction to Kane once again, Kane's girlfriend Angie, and Kane's protege Hob, who is like 12 years old or something.
Can't shoot a kid, can you, fucker?
We also get the return of Lewis, Murphy's badass partner. The two put a stop to the operation. And we see that Murphy has been keeping an eye on his wife and kid, leading to her suing OCP. So Murphy gets a talking to by one of OCP's lawyers.
Do you think you could ever be a husband to her? What can you offer her? Companionship? Love? You are simply a machine, nothing more.
Sounds familiar.
What did you think? You were an ordinary police officer? You're our product.
Murphy then gets a chance to talk to his wife in what is essentially one of the most emotional scenes in the series, but he lies to her so that she can forget him.
Your husband is dead.
We soon learn that the city of Detroit is in debt and owes money to OCP, and OCP is going to foreclose on the city, and Detroit will be the first city owned and operated by a major corporation. We are also introduced to new characters. The mayor of Detroit, who I love, named Mayor Cusack, his councilman or something, and OCP's Dr. Juliet Fax. We are also reintroduced to the number one at OCP, the old man, Johnson from the first film, and their top lawyer, who we met a couple scenes ago. OCP has spent 5 months and $90 million on their new project titled Robocop 2. Real original name there, guys. This is also one of the best scenes in the franchise.
Stop or I'll shoot.
I was laughing my ass off at how bad these new models were. It's hilarious. And the old man's reactions, even better. Johnson has been in charge of this project, and he gets sidestepped by Dr. Fax. Their roles similar to Dick Jones and Bob Morton from the first film.
Thank you for your concern, Mr. Morton. I'm sure this is something we can take up in my office at a
moment. Maybe what we need here is a fresh perspective.
With all due respect, Dr. Fax, your area of expertise is psychology, not robotics.
There's no harm in hearing the young lady out, is there, Johnson?
No, sir.
We are reintroduced to the police strike. Sergeant Warren Reed, and we also meet a crooked cop who works for Kane named Officer Duffy. Murphy and Lewis track Hob to an arcade and barge in, resulting in Hob getting away and Robocop interrogating Duffy, who spills the beans on Kane's hideout. Kane and his men use the power of magnetism to subdue and capture Murphy, and they proceed to take him apart, and they throw what is left of him at the front of the police station to send a message. Johnson learns that Dr. Fax wants to use criminals and death row inmates as the base for the new RoboCop 2, which I'm sure can't go wrong at all. He delivers this news to the old man in order to get her fired, as she is now pushing him out and pushing her way up the corporate ladder. Unfortunately, Johnson learns that Dr. Fax is providing the old man with something that Johnson cannot provide.
Bring a bucket and a mop for this wet-ass P-word.
OCP wants to keep RoboCop offline, but they eventually repair him, but they program him with new directives to make him more child-friendly.
That destructive behavior. He's become a role model for our children. Now what are we teaching them?
Like, visit an orphanage.
He could speak out on environmental issues.
If he just talked things out with people instead of firing that big gun of his.
Or help a cat out of a tree, or go door to door collecting for the Red Cross, or maybe even roasting some marshmallows with some Cub Scouts.
These new directives make Murphy pretty much useless in battle and unable to function properly at all because he's got over 100 different new directives.
You have the right to an attorney.
You're reading Miranda to a corpse!
I'm having trouble. Thank you for not smoking.
In order to get rid of these directives, they would need a few million volts, and that could possibly undo the directives, but it might kill him. Murphy forces himself to be electrocuted, and he is good as new. And he leads his fellow officers on a strike against Kane. Hob and Angie get away, but Hob gets into a car chase battle with RoboCop. RoboCop gets on a motorcycle, which is visually one of the coolest things ever.
Shut up! They see me rolling, they hating, trying to catch me riding dirty.
Kane then gets captured by Murphy. Dr. Fax decides to use Kane as the base for RoboCop 2. She cuts off his life support and quickly gets to work on her psychotic cyborg. Hob decides to not rescue Kane and decides that instead he will be the one to lead Kane's empire of crime. The mayor is running a hotline for donations to help bail out the city of Detroit from the debt they owe OCP. Hob contacts Mayor Cusack and offers to bail out the city after discussing terms.
Tell you what, put me down for 50 just to make sure.
50 cents, $50. That's cute.
Don't be a queer. 50 million.
OCP learns of this meeting and send in RoboCop 2 to kill the mayor and everyone in attendance of the meeting. Unfortunately, Fax uses Nuke as leverage against Kane. Once on the scene, Kane kills everyone except for the mayor, who escapes using the sewers. We are now nearing the end as OCP holds a press conference to discuss the future of Detroit under their rule and show off RoboCop 2. I love it when the mayor recognizes RoboCop 2, who I'm going to refer as RoboCane from now on. The old man pulls out some Nuke to show off how drugs are polluting the city, unaware that Kane is addicted to the shit. And RoboCane soon goes on a rampage and proceeds to battle RoboCop.
Behave yourselves!
A huge battle takes place, and RoboCop takes out RoboCane by ripping out his brain and smashing it on the floor. Johnson suggests that they put the blame on Dr. Fax, and the old man agrees. He and Johnson leave, and the film ends kind of abruptly.
Son of a bitch is getting away with it. You can't even touch him.
Patience, Lewis. We're only human.
The ending is good. Not as good as RoboCop 1's ending, which is one of the best film endings of all time. But, if anything, the ending for RoboCop 2 gets you hyped for RoboCop 3. Alright, now that you know what happened in the film, let's get into some of the characters.
That's the sound of the police!
Now, this isn't one specific character, But I love how even though most of the cops are striking, they still care for Murphy and treat him as one of their own. When he electrocutes himself, they all rush to his aid and try to carry him to get up. Not a single one of the cops in this film calls RoboCop RoboCop. They always call him Murphy, which is a really neat little detail.
You really had us worried there, Murphy.
What's bugging you, Murph?
How you feeling, Murphy? Shyster! He's one of mine. I want him back on his feet.
And at one point, when Murphy walks around the precinct without his visor, not a single cop stares or points at him.
Prepare to fire!
Hey, wait a second!
Get a cop, for God's sake!
Hey, stop, you can't do that!
We have orders to destroy it!
Oh, shit!
You're maniacs!
Now, getting to RoboCop. RoboCop is once again played by Peter Weller, and again, he is excellent in the role. RoboCop is as good as he's ever been. I love how we delve a little bit into his family situation. And the scene between him and his wife is so good. I also appreciate that they kept in the gunslinging and how he will occasionally shoot without looking, like in the first RoboCop. There's so many good scenes and moments with him, like him ricocheting the bullet to save the baby from a bad guy.
I'll do it! I'll fucking kill it!
We can't have that.
Or punching that one guy through a door.
Surprise, motherfucker!
Nancy Allen also once again returns as Officer Ann Lewis, and she is great. Prepare to hear me say blank person has returned and they are great, because it's true for everyone who returns. I love how she always has Murphy's back. And she is always willing to put her life on the line in the battle against gangsters and even drug-addicted, murderous cyborgs. Sergeant Reed is once again played excellently by Robert Dolqui. Sorry if I'm mispronouncing that last name. And this kind of gets into one of the negatives of the movie, but I always wanted more from him. Sergeant Reed was one of the gems from the first film, and he barely makes a few appearances in this film. He feels more like he has a cameo in the film rather than a role.
And I don't want to hear any more talk about strike. We're not plumbers. We're police officers. And police officers don't strike. Listen, pal, your client's a scumbag. You're a scumbag, and scumbags see the judge on Monday morning. Now get out of my police station and take Laughing Boy with you.
This project doesn't concern cops. It's classified. It's OCP. You got it, mister?
Yeah, I got it.
Sorry, Sarge. Fucked up?
Forget it, kid. This guy's a serious asshole.
Now, while as a whole, this movie's villains pale in comparison to the first film's villains, there are plenty of standouts here once again.
Where's your partner?
Well, guys, the other one was upstairs. She was sweet. I took her out.
I got the muscle to shove enough of this factory so far up your stupid wop ass that you'll shit snow for a year.
Frankie, blow this cocksucker's head off.
Ooh, guns, guns, guns. Come on, Sal. The Tigers are playing two nights. I never miss a game.
Come quietly or there will be trouble.
Ah, fuck you!
Kane is pretty fantastic. He is religious and can be scary and intimidating at times.
Jesus had days like this. Hounded and attacked like a criminal. But like him, I don't blame you.
You said you were just gonna scare him!
Doesn't he look scared?
Even when he becomes a cyborg, he still, like Murphy, retains some of his previous traits and memories. Even when he is a robot, they give him memorable traits like the digital face cam thingy. He's still addicted to drugs, and as RoboCane, he is physically imposing, and I really like his design. Anyway, Kane is a worthy follow-up to the first film's Clarence Boddicker.
Pay the man.
All right.
I love the decision to put a 12-year-old into the script to be a protege of Kane. One of the best scenes is where Kane has Duffy tortured and killed for selling him out to RoboCop, and he forces Hob to watch. Hob is being molded into a successor for Kane, which is awesome. The kid even has his own personal gun. Hob is cocky and has quite the potty mouth.
Shit. You look a little out of breath, bitch.
Damn it, Hob, Kane needs us.
Fuck Kane!
Mouth off like that again, and it's no more nuke for you, bitch. Guess you're in some pretty deep shit. We don't go shoving our shit down anybody's throat. And we don't advertise it like they do with cigarettes or booze.
Ah, he reminds me of myself when I was his age. Hob is also the main focus of one of the best scenes in the series, as he lays dying, bleeding out on a pile of money as RoboCop comes across him.
Lie still.
I love how he acts afraid of Robo at first, but realizes that Murphy isn't there to hurt him. It always gets to me when he reaches out for Murphy's hand so that Murphy doesn't leave him.
I'm cold.
You are going into shock. I will call for a medical emergency unit.
Wait, no. Don't leave me.
I won't leave you.
Such a good scene and a great character. Now we get to the corporation, OCP itself. Johnson, Dr. Fax, the slick back hair lawyer guy, and the old man are all excellent. I also love how Johnson plays a much larger role in this one compared to in the original RoboCop, where he was more in the background. These characters all do an excellent job in portraying the themes that they represent. Corporate greed. Cue the segue. These films may be called RoboCop, but the most prominent plot point and theme in these films isn't justice or life as a cop or anything. Rather, in both, the biggest and most prominent theme is corporate greed.
Take a close look at the track record of this company, and you'll see that we have gambled in markets traditionally regarded as non-profit. Hospitals, prisons, space exploration. I say good business is where you find it.
Johnson rose the ranks from RoboCop 1 to 2 because Bob Morton and Dick Jones died in the first. Just as Bob Morton sidestepped Dick Jones to rise in the company's ranks, Dr. Fax sidestepped Johnson to rise the ranks. And as soon as Fax tries to walk all over him, he does his best to get her fired. The plot point about OCP, a corporation, ripping off an entire city so that the corporation itself can gain more power and literally own a city is another great plot point.
When are you going to stop paying the cops so they'll go back to work?
We're not a charity. The city owes us over $37 million.
Well, you'll have to cut us some slack. Well,
a deadline's a deadline, sorry.
How are we supposed to raise that kind of money with things the way they are?
You aren't. We don't expect you to pay.
Let me refer you to our contract. In the event of default, OCP shall have the uncontested right of foreclosure on all city assets.
So you're saying we miss one payment and you can foreclose?
We can and we will. We're taking Detroit private.
So you deliberately undermined our credit?
That was the easy part.
And you engineered the police strike. You want Detroit to tear itself apart so you can raid it like you would any other corporation? You're murderers.
I'd advise you to say nothing further. It might be actionable.
They toy with the lives of regular people such as Murphy, Kane, cops, and the people of Detroit. And they don't give a crap about displacing the people of Detroit and ripping them from their homes to create their new perfect little empire.
Well, he signed the release forms and he joined the force. He's legally dead.
we can do pretty much what we want to.
He doesn't have a name. He's got a program. He's product. Is that clear?
You have to tear down a lot of people's houses before you can make that thing. And then take away their home. Won't be much room for neighborhoods, huh? Not like the kind that we all grew up in.
These days, neighborhoods just seem to be the sort of places where bad things happen.
What about democracy? Nobody elected you.
Anyone can buy OCP stock and own a piece of our city. What could be more democratic than that?
The whole theme about corporate greed comes together when the film ends with Johnson suggesting that they put the entirety of the blame for RoboCop 2, aka Robocane, on Dr. Fax, so that Johnson himself, the lawyer, and the old man can all come out unscathed.
Good thinking.
I also love how at the end the old man walks over a dead police officer that was in his way to get to his limo. Or how instead of worrying about the death and destruction they are responsible for, the old man is worried about the company's image and bottom line.
This could look bad for OCP, Johnson. Scramble the best spin team we have.
The theme of corporate greed is just as good in RoboCop 2 as it was in the original RoboCop. Would you be surprised if I told you the action in this movie was great? Because it's not great. It's super great. As I said in my first review, Murphy can be clunky and slow, and so you really need to plan out the action and the variety of the action. How does each action scene and set piece differ? Here, the action is as good as ever. Sure, there's plenty of gangsters shooting at RoboCop as bullets ping off of him repeatedly, but that doesn't account for all of, or even most of the action. The three standout scenes slash sequences for me are the car chase between RoboCop and Kane, the introduction of RoboCane, and the big finale of the film. The car chase between Kane and Murphy is great. It's really well shot and exciting. There's plenty of memorable moments. You've seen car chases in RoboCop before, so to spice things up, RoboCop is going to cling to Kane's van as Kane tries to shake him off. Then RoboCop steals a dude's motorcycle, looking dope as hell while riding it. And then the two proceed to play chicken, resulting in Murphy throwing himself into Kane's windshield. This whole action scene and chase is great. Then there's the introduction of RoboCane, and this action set piece feels like it's more out of a horror film than an action film. There's barely any light, as Kane shoots out the lights once he appears, the only lights coming from himself. It's dark and moody as Kane is lighting up parts of the warehouse with his searchlights. He guns about 6 to 8 people down in the beginning, but the rest of the scene is more of a deadly game of hide and seek. Hob and the mayor are skulking around and sneaking around RoboCane. It's as if they are being hunted and stalked by a horror movie monster. Kane kills Angie in what is perhaps the film's most grotesque death with some great sound effects. Then there's the finale of the film where it all goes balls to the walls. RoboCop and RoboCane get into a huge battle. They don't just keep the fighting in one room or area as well. It takes place in a few locations like the press conference room, a hallway, an elevator shaft, the roof, a basement, and the streets of Detroit. At first, Murphy was probably like, Ed 209's weakness was stairs. I'll just throw him down some stairs. Aw, crap. He can walk upstairs. Okay, if I can't throw you down some stairs, I'll throw you down an elevator shaft. Fuck. This is as good as any time to bring up the special effects of the film. The effects are excellent for the most part, but there are some times where the stop motion footage of our actors and blue screen footage looks a little dated. Once on the roof, I was like, oh man, that does not look so hot. But then I immediately got sucked back into the film when RoboCop pulls one of the most alpha male Chad moves ever.
You're coming with me, Kane.
This action scene in particular is also varied up quite a bit because unlike Ed 209 versus RoboCop from the first film, Murphy here has backup and we get a couple minutes of SWAT, police officers, and Lewis backing up Murphy to help fight RoboCane. And did I say that Murphy pulled the most Chad move in the film? Well, his Chad move is almost immediately rivaled in Chadliness by Lewis stealing an armored vehicle from OCP and hitting Kane with it. This final battle is bombastic and awesome and doesn't get boring. This might be a wild idea or opinion, but fuck it, I'm just gonna say it. RoboCop 2 is hilarious and it is funnier than the original RoboCop. I can't really think of many ways of saying this is funny or that was funny. I'd just be repeating myself over and over saying this was funny. So instead, here's a small compilation of moments that I found hilarious, both from the film itself and the film's satiric commercials that satirize American life. The film is funny as hell. Enough said.
No embarrassing alarm noise. No need to trouble the police. And it won't even run down your battery.
Magnavolt. Lethal response.
On the international scene, the Amazon nuclear power facility has blown its stack, irradiating the world's largest rainforest. Environmentalists call it a disaster.
But don't they always?
Well, will 50 do it?
Oh, yes, that'll do it. Don't you guys think that'll do it?
Yeah.
50 mil. That will do it. That'll do it.
For God's sake, Marv, these people are criminals. Why do you have to label people? I hate labels.
Now, we get to the film's problems. As I said earlier, I love Sergeant Reed and I wanted more of him. Next is not a major complaint, but a bit of a small gripe. Throughout the first film, there was a clear change in Murphy as he learned more about himself and grabbed hold of his humanity once again. From his beginnings as RoboCop to the end of the film, his speech patterns and ways of speaking changed. He is very robotic and static in the beginning of the first film in the way he talks, but by the end he sounds much more human and much more like a person as he projects and emotes in his voice. He sounds less and less like a robot as the film progresses.
Drop the gun, you are under arrest. Madam, you have suffered an emotional shock. I will notify a rape crisis center.
How can I help you, Officer Lewis?
Murphy had a wife and son. What happened to them?
Clarence!
I give up.
I'm not arresting you anymore.
Nice shooting, son. What's your name?
Murphy.
But as soon as RoboCop 2 starts, he speaks more like he did in the beginning of the first film rather than how he did at the end of the first. He is less expressive in his voice, and it bugs me a little. It would have made the scene where he becomes more robotic again even better because he would be talking more robotically. But once he's rewired, he acts a little weird, but he speaks almost exactly the same as he did in the beginning of the film. His speech pattern doesn't change.
Where is it made?
Freeze. Nobody move. This is a bust.
Isn't this a school day?
Dead or alive?
One of us must die.
Dead then.
How you feeling, Murphy?
I'm just fine, Warren. Thank you for asking. Pity. It's a beautiful morning. Chained to waste it.
Ready for duty, partner?
You betcha.
You can't even touch him.
Patience, Lewis. We're only human.
There is also a distinct lack of blood compared to the first film's surreal hyperviolence. There's one shot in particular where RoboCane guns down like 6 people and there's little to no blood at all. The man is using a machine gun, if I may remind you.
Hey,
Also, early on, the film feels like it's setting up Murphy's family and they will have a big role to play in the film, but that storyline goes nowhere. We never learn what happened with the suit Mrs. Murphy filed. She just gets in her car and is never seen again. What the hell? This literally, it goes nowhere. It's dumb. And where the fuck is the RoboCop theme? The music for the most part is fine, but they never once play the RoboCop theme in RoboCop 2. If you know anything about me, it's that RoboCop has one of the best goddamn theme songs for any character in anything ever. And they never, not even once, play it in this movie. Music plays a huge part in media and can be used to hype up the audience and improve scenes, especially action scenes. Nothing demonstrates this better than when the opening song for an anime plays during an action scene in an anime. RoboCop's theme was sorely missing here, and it sucks because there was at least two spots where it would have been perfect to have been used. But instead, it just doesn't get played at all. Here, let's just compare these two scenes where I think it could have been used.
Son of a bitch is getting away with it. You can't even touch him.
Patience, Lewis. We're only human.
Son of a bitch is getting away with it. You can't even touch him.
Patience, Lewis. We're only human.
Dead or alive, you are coming with me.
It's just disappointing that they didn't use RoboCop's theme in RoboCop 2. It just sucks. RoboCop 2 is a fantastic film that is a worthy successor to the original. In fact, it even surpasses the original in some ways. It's definitely one of the best sequels to a movie ever made. I just wish I could say the same for RoboCop 3. Remember how I said the ending for RoboCop 2 makes you hyped and excited to see what the future has in store for Murphy and Lewis in the battle against OCP? Well, if I had to use a clip from RoboCop 2 to demonstrate how I feel about RoboCop 3, it would be this.
In every way, an improvement over the original. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you RoboCop
3. Come quietly or there will be trouble.
Ah, fuck you.
Look forward to the RoboCop 3 review, guys. I'm not looking forward to having to rewatch the film, but I have to. Anyway, thanks for watching, everyone. Be sure to comment, like, subscribe. Spreading the word about my videos would be very much appreciated. Anyway, be ready for a review on RoboCop 3 very soon. And remember, you matter.